kgnu.org. Yes, gentle listeners, you are tuned in to Metro on your community radio station, KGNU Boulder, Denver, 88.5 FM, 1390 on your AM dial. And this is going to be a really great show. We've got, as our guest this afternoon, Keri Smith, the statewide campaign manager for Padres y Jóvenes Unidos. Welcome to the studio.
Thank you.
Yes, Keri, why don't you tell KGNU's listeners a little bit about just the general framework of what the work Padres y Jóvenes Unidos does?
Definitely. So we are a educational justice organization based here in Denver, Colorado, and we work in many campaigns across the educational system, such as health justice, ensuring college preparation for all, and ending the school to jail track in Colorado.
What is your particular role with Padres y Jóvenes? You said there's a lot of campaigns. What do you do?
Yes. So my particular role is in the ending the school to jail track campaign, and I am the statewide campaign manager. And so most importantly, my role is to take the deep history that Padres has in the community and using our skills and tools and lessons learned, as well as recent legislation, to restorative justice and fair and equitable discipline practices to school districts across the state.
Okay, great. So what you are referring to is the Smart School Discipline Law, which is a statewide law that Padres y Jóvenes was instrumental in helping to create awareness and get this law passed. Right? There's like just tremendous amount of youth activism combined with parents and our teachers, everybody involved with.
Yes, teachers, our allied teachers play a huge role in our local work, where our youth groups, Jóvenes Unidos, Youth United, play a big role in the movement. We have to have those principals and those teachers who welcome us into the schools, see the value in the work. And they are instrumental in implementing things such as the Smart School Discipline Law or Fair and Equitable Discipline, as they are the ones who dish it out, I guess.
Okay, so what does the Smart School Discipline Law change for school districts in Colorado?
All right, so the Smart School Discipline Law in 2012 took a lot of the existing zero tolerance, harsh punishment, exclusionary practices that we've had since before the early 2000s, and identified and really declared how zero tolerance and harsh punishment are unnecessary, that our roles, our school's roles, should not be to exclude students, rather keep them in school, and not refer students to the criminal justice system. Additionally, it identified that our school administrators should be allowed more discretion. There were parts of our state law, as well as school discipline practices and policies, that made suspensions and expulsions mandatory for certain acts. And so now they are no longer mandatory, except for federal guided laws that refer to weapons and in school. Okay. And so Yeah, and so that they said that the discipline policies also must apply equally to all children in the school.
Which there was a wider discretion in sort of the use of, I guess, punitive tactics against kids. So you would have in one school someone being punished very differently for a similar act to in another school. Is that right?
Yeah, that and it actually can even be within the same school. So what we found in a lot of our work, actually a lot of the youth work, the youth really led this work, was that there actually were racial disparities in the use of particular and often punitive or exclusionary discipline practices. So in our Colorado statewide report card that came out earlier this year, for the state of Colorado as a whole, we saw that in the discipline practices across the state, for every one white student who was suspended, expelled, or referred to law enforcement, there was actually four black students to every one. For Latino students, there was almost two students to every one white peer who was disciplined like that. And then for Native Americans, it was over two to every one white student who was suspended, expelled, or referred to law enforcement for the same infraction.
Wow. Okay. So that's the work that you're now engaged in making different municipalities, different school districts pay attention to and implement and try to find some measurement for their, participation in the Smart School Discipline Program. How do you do that? And what are some of the differences between like a rural community or a larger suburban community's school districts when it comes to this?
Okay, yeah. So the applying this across the state level, there's so many factors, right? So there's actual policies that exist within each district across the state. There's 178 of them, 179 depending on who you talk to. And each one of them has jurisdiction over their area and decides, the school board decides what the policies are going to state. And then the principals and assistant principals, and then down the chain of command, are responsible for implementing those policies or using them to run their schools. And so one thing that the Smart School Discipline Law stated was that schools were responsible for updating and revising their school district policies to, in fact, reflect the changes made in with the Smart School Discipline Law. So that's one area of it. However, the next part is that adopting a policy doesn't guarantee implementation. So through the use of our statewide report card that we will do annually, and using the percentages of exclusionary practices as well as racial disparities, and comparing that to once we've identified what policies exist across the state, we'll hopefully be able to identify best practices and highlight those and hopefully use them as resources for other schools, as well as highlight areas that need assistance. And so that idea between the rural, suburban, and even urban areas would be that in identifying these places that are succeeding or the policies are being implemented correctly or in a way that just functions to keep kids in school, right, and making it fair and equal for all students, would then apply to places in Colorado that are similar. So we're not taking, a Denver policy might not work in Cortez, Colorado, and, a Greeley policy might not work in Boulder. So really being able to identify the areas that we're working in and what's working for who and why, and then being able to share that practice with the rest of the state.
And the main goal, of course, throughout is keeping kids in school.
Yeah.
Eliminating the opportunities for them to be marginalized. And so that ties to another campaign going on with Padres y Jóvenes, which is the Know Your Rights campaign. How does, tell us a little bit about the Know Your Rights campaign.
Definitely. So the Know Your Rights campaign, so in talking about all of the discipline practices that exist, and when we're talking about the school-to-jail track, or some people might be more familiar with the school-to-prison pipeline, is the idea is that through referrals to police officers, suspensions, expulsions, we're actually removing kids from the learning environment and actually exponentially increasing their risks of, people would say dropping out, and we call it pushing out, right? Because that's not an environment in which kids can necessarily learn or feel wanted. As well as other things such as having a harsh record or knowing a harsh discipline record and knowing what's on there and being able to learn from your mistakes and have access to the things that are documented about you or being able to advocate for yourself if you disagree with the decisions that are being made. And so the Know Your Rights campaign is right now based out of our local and the School Digital Track campaign in DPS schools. And what it does is it takes, there's four topics, if you will, that our current resources focus on right now, and that's suspensions, expulsions, tickets, and then also discipline records. And what these do is they take the discipline policies that are in Denver Public Schools, and then in a question-answer format, really explain to students what the policies say for their school, as well as what their rights are. So if you're being suspended, there's a hearing. There's a process that administrators have to follow, which is notifying guardians, sending home letters, making phone calls, and then holding a hearing, just to kind of a parent conference, if you will, is what we might have referred to it back in the day. Now they're called hearings.
Okay.
And so
that's kind of telling, isn't
it? It's very telling. And so then what happens is most people, we know that the schools have responsibilities and procedures that they have to follow, but we just don't know what they are, let alone what our rights are within them, so that you can contest or you can argue that you shouldn't be being suspended. A recent story, a student who was removed from school, he was up for expulsion, mother was to take the student to the expulsion hearing, and family was quite distraught. I mean, the student had excelled pretty well in school, really enjoyed it, but the student was up for expulsion because he brought a small pocket knife to school. Immediately removed, following rules and procedures. However, the school didn't discover until after they removed the student, until he was already being removed from the educational experience, that he was carrying that pocket knife as a form of protection in his travels walking to and from school. So the parent and the student worked with Padres, and we were able to inform them of what the policies say, what their rights are, and they actually were able to walk into the hearing, which, by the way, when they went in, it was the mom and the student, and I want to say 4 to 6 administrators. Quite an intimidating environment, let alone if you don't know what's happening or what your rights are. And so they actually were able to... I'm sorry, let me backtrack a little bit. So when they walked in, the administrators very, very kindly and framed as generously offered the student and the parent the ability to transfer to an alternative school. That they weren't going to expel them, and you know they wanted the best for the student, so let's go ahead and transfer them. Well, the reality is that in Colorado, transfers are voluntary. You do not have to do it. They are not mandatory. Nobody can force you to do it. So working with Padres and having the information available to them, they knew that. And they were able to deny the transfer and process through with going back and forth and sharing stories and experiences. And actually, the student is now back in school, re-engaged in getting the education he should be.
You are tuned into Metro on your radio station of your very own, KGNU Community Radio. We want to thank everybody who was supportive of our fall pledge drive in the past couple weeks. You are the ones that give us the opportunity to bring you these kind of stories. And we are speaking with Keri Smith, statewide campaign manager for Padres y Jóvenes Unidos, which is really a nationwide leader in education or organization, would you say?
Yes, definitely. The Smart School Discipline Law that we've been talking about is actually arguably one of the most comprehensive in the country regarding fair and equitable discipline in our schools and holding schools and communities accountable.
So what other examples are there of kids needing to know their rights or parents needing to know what their rights are to participate and not kind of get run over by the bureaucracy of their schools?
Definitely. I know a lot when folks talk about the school-to-prison pipeline or ending the school-to-jail track, we often talk about these really harsh examples or, you know, expulsions and police are involved, and that paints a picture of quite dramatic things, but there's smaller things such as discipline records. And when I go to talk to folks, adults to youth, don't know that the schools keep discipline records on them. And from kindergarten all the way to the last grade you complete, graduation, people keep a record on you. So if you've been referred to the principal's office, if you got in a shoving match with your friend, if you brought candy into school when you weren't supposed to, that all gets recorded. And it's actually really easy to access, in the sense that a lot of school personnel have access to those files. And that discipline record is used for a lot. If a student wants to go on a field trip or attend prom, or participate in sports, oftentimes educators and administrators refer to the discipline record to see if the student would be allowed, to give permission to do these things. Another local example was, there was a young girl who was up for a college scholarship to go play soccer for the college, and the recruiter came all the way out to the school to check everything out and interview her, and pretty advanced in the process. And part of the application to college and part of the process of getting approved for scholarships and acceptance, admittance, is referring to your school records. And so when the recruiter asked, which is typical, the school for the discipline records, the recruiter then saw that the student had a altercation with another girl her freshman year of high school. And so the student had excellent grades, had been deeply involved and actually excelled in soccer. And when we were talking to her, she explained that, you know, I came into high school, it's the beginning of high school, it's really rough. And I maybe made some poor choices, but I've really done a really great job with applying myself. And the student actually ended up losing that scholarship based on the fact that she had had isolated incident 3 years prior in her freshman year of high school. So a big impact for something that isn't talked about that much, or most people don't know about.
Indeed. So one of the, I'd say, hallmarks of Padres y Jóvenes is the participation of the jóvenes, the young people who are activists and are able to get a firm handle on their education and how they are going, you know, through the whole learning process. So, you know, youth activism in Colorado is something that's been on the national spotlight, with the kids obviously in Jeffco going, striking out, the big strike, walking out of the classes and agitating for their history books to not, or their history curriculum to not be changed. So how does that style of youth activism fit with what Padres y Jóvenes does?
So it was beautiful and exciting. So Padres is located on the west side of Denver, and actually maybe a few blocks from our office, maybe a few blocks from Jeffco. And it was very inspiring to see the Jefferson County youth organize and act on behalf of their beliefs. It was really empowering to see them have a say in their education and what materials were provided to them. And Padres, you know, for the topics and the subjects that were being brought up in Jefferson County, really it is our history that would be erased from the textbooks. It would be the struggles and the fights and the successes and the wins of communities of colors and those most marginalized that would be removed from the textbooks. And so it was really inspirational to see what they were doing, and we hope that it's not a limited thing, and that students know that they do have power and they do have a lot of say in their education, and we want to help them raise their voices.
Were there times when the conversation around this school to jail pipeline was just getting started, where the kids from Padres y Jóvenes felt that they needed to do these kind of direct action tactics?
Definitely. Historically, please don't quote me on the year. I want to say it was probably 2005, but youth themselves organized a walkout based on the environmental conditions of the schools they were in. I know that the local campaign of Padres is based in Southwest Denver, and it is a community that has faced struggle in educational and access to community resources for years, and has really organized to work and together and again raise those voices and let parents and youth have a voice in their community.
Okay, so for a little bit more history about education and racial disparity with education here, KGNU is working with the History Colorado Center on an oral history series where people are talking about their experience with the court-ordered racial integration of the Denver Public Schools via busing. And this is a program that ended in 1995. There was the decision that the schools were they would naturally integrate themselves. And so what we've been hearing actually from people anecdotally is that the Denver Public Schools are as much, if not more, racially segregated than they were before busing happened. So no big system like this is going to come into place now, but what is the modern equivalent of busing in order to try to bridge the gap of racial disparities in education?
Definitely, and to apply that to particularly the school, the jail track, and understanding that what the busing efforts were an attempt to find a solution to the problem. And for us, you know, the problem is that we need to end, or zero tolerance and harsh punishment is a problem. Criminalization of our youth is a problem. And we know that the solutions are to stop doing those things, as well as prepare educators and administrators and students and parents to create communities of respect, which then encourage dialogue and a sense of belonging and connection. And when you have that type of environment and you feel a sense of belonging, then discipline or following the rules, there should always be rules, right?
Right.
It's done because there's ownership there. There's the belonging is really key. There's a reason to follow those rules because you feel like it counts for you. And so for us, as a solution and overhaul, I think that the Smart School Discipline Law was a great attempt at doing that and having the larger impact. But just like busing and like as you said, the getting rid of busing in the 90s and the arguments that schools are actually probably more segregated now than they were before, it is that adoption or making a claim to something existing is one thing, but acting and having people who have the power invested in it is the key. And that's really our goal, is to make sure that it is the youth and the parents who are the people who have the power and are invested in using that power to create the best situation.
Listeners, you are tuned into Metro on KGNU Community Radio. We are speaking with Keri Smith, the statewide campaign manager for Padres y Jóvenes Unidos, working on juvenile justice. Do you call it restorative justice?
It has a million names. we do, and this is actually a great discussion we've been having, is this idea of restorative justice. As long as I think restorative, the word, right? Justice, the word, practices, the word, are all really key and useful in spreading the message. Implementation, right? The use of those things and the reason, the spirit behind those words is really more important. So restorative justice works as kind of a blanket term, but yes.
Okay. But more solutions-based is really the focus of your work.
Yes.
And what is it, aside from trying to prevent something bad from happening, how does this whole effort ensure that, you know, good things happen?
So yeah, definitely prevention is great. to ensure that good things are happening, it really comes again in the youth organizing and the parent organizing, and seeing communities play such a big role, and in these systems that often feel stranger from or disenfranchising to the communities that are most affected by these policies and practices. And so the bigger picture is that, you know, in having this and spreading the message that this isn't how it has to be. Zero tolerance doesn't work, and that's okay that it doesn't work, and we can do something about it, would then, you know, have, you know, we're talking future educators, future principals who are coming in, and having that be the future of who's leading us. Informed voters with elections coming up, right? Letting people know what their rights are and what power they have to change things.
Indeed. If this is a topic that is interesting to you out there, KGNU listeners, I'd like to let you know that this evening at the University of Denver, DU is welcoming juvenile justice expert Rosa Maria Ortiz, the IACHR commissioner and special reporter. She is speaking today at, 5 p.m. from 5 to 6:30 at the University of Denver Sturm College of Law on 2255 East Evans Avenue. Ms. Ortiz is going to be discussing the report issued by the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, the standards that it puts forth, and how those standards are either applied or not applied in the United States and the Americas. This is all about juvenile justice in Colorado and throughout the Americas. Ms. Ortiz is a citizen of Paraguay. She's been vice president of the UN Committee on the Rights of the Child and advisor on human rights and cultural diversity for the Paraguayan presidency's National Secretariat of Culture. So these are big issues, you know, juvenile justice and how we are to, let children learn from their mistakes instead of make them just pay and pay for them. How does the youth make their voice heard on enough of a scale to where they've got a chance?
I think it starts, and it's easier said than done, but simply getting involved, right? Sharing their stories. I mean, the two stories I shared with you today are ones that aren't foreign to us. And in fact, I would say we hear them too often. But being able to share those stories, it really relates, because when we're talking about discipline and juvenile justice and school safety, those words come with a lot of images of a lot of emotions, and fear being a big one. And without the explanation or the understanding of what is truly being experienced in our schools and understanding who it's most affecting, we don't have the tools, and it's harder to sway the masses that this really is the right direction to take things. And really, that youth are so innovative, and they communication and their voice is just so powerful that this can't be done without them. So they are integral in continuing this movement and pushing it forward.
So where can KGNU listeners get some more information about Padres y Jóvenes Unidos, and generally, you know, the Know Your Rights campaign and the entire smart school discipline law?
The easiest and most convenient would be to visit us at padresunidos.org, as well as feeling free. Daniel Kim is the director of youth organizing, and myself, the statewide campaign manager, facilitate the school to jail track campaigns, but we'd be happy to get you in contact with any of our other campaigns, parent organizers, health justice leaders, to get you involved anyway, or provide more information or resources.
That sounds great. So, well, Keri Smith, statewide campaign manager for Padres y Jóvenes, thank you for joining us here on Metro.
Thank you for having me.
For sure. And listeners, please stay tuned for Democracy Now!